Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. We are continuing with the lecture on neoplasia, and we begin with a scenario. A 62-year-old man has an unexpected 5 kg weight loss over 3 months. His liver span is 17 cm, 5 cm below the right costal margin, and he has occult blood in his stool. Before further workup can be done, he dies in a motor vehicle accident. At autopsy, the medical examiner finds the massively enlarged liver shown in the image. Coming. Questions are usually, what is the cause of hepatomegaly? What does the stool white test likely indicate? Why did he have weight loss? Here is the image shown. Look at the masses, multiple masses shown here. These are the lesions in the liver, and brownish is the liver in the background, and the pale whitish masses are scattered throughout the liver. So you may find answer to this, and in the subsequent, like other lectures, we will be having answers in that also. We are taking up with the benign and malignant tumors. You can see in the image, the normal cells has got a normal NC ratio, and the cells are clustered together, which are abnormal cells, shown in the lower, on the left side, in the lower panel, abnormal cells are clustered together, and they are encased in the connective tissue capsule, and surrounding tissue also reveals cells. Whereas in the malignant tumors, you can just compare normal cell with the malignant cells. The normal cells has maintained their NC ratio, whereas the abnormal cells, which are known as the cancer cell, labeled in this diagram on the right side as a malignant tumor. The tumor cells has got the high NC ratio, irregular nuclei, and which are deep staining, and then is the variable size and shape, and they are just clustered, loosely cohesive cells are there. Whereas in the benign tumor, they were tightly clustered, and in the malignant tumor, they are loosely cohesive cells. What is the difference between the benign and malignant tumors? This is a usually commonly asked question, whether you are attempting your SEQ or maybe some part of the MCQs also, and even in the Viva also. Benign tumors are usually localized, whereas malignant are local and distant spread is seen in that. Rate of growth is slow in the benign and rapid in the malignant one. Boundaries. In benign tumor, the boundaries are circumscribed, often encapsulated, whereas in the malignant, the boundaries are irregular, non-encapsulated. A relationship to the surrounding tissue in benign, they compress the surrounding normal tissues, whereas the malignant invades and destroys the surrounding normal tissue. Effects. In benign tumors, produced by the pressure on the surrounding structure as vessels and nerves and organs. Whereas malignant tumor destroys structures. Treatment in case of benign is removal will alleviate, whereas in the malignant, removal will not restore the function. Now, the important is between the carcinoma and sarcoma. The carcinomas are epithelial tumor which are going to arise from the epithelial elements, whereas sarcomas are derived from the mesenchymal tissues. Carcinomas are common among the general population, whereas sarcomas are rare, only 1% out of the population have them. Primarily affects the people over 50 years age. This is about carcinoma. Whereas sarcoma mostly affects children and young adults. And in the carcinomas, carcinoma types include the sides, lungs, liver, stomach, colon and rectum cancer. Whereas sarcomas, the commonest types include bone, muscle, fat, nerves, cartilage, fibrous tissue, and blood cancers. Normal cells may become the cancer cells. This diagram will give you a background and good idea to be retained in the mind. Look at the normal tissue, then is the hyperplasia, then dysplasia, and then is the cancer. This is an example given in the stratified squamous epithelium. Look at the lining. Here, squamous cells are well maintained with normal NC ratio in the normal, whereas in hyperplasia they are increasing number now, and in the dysplasia the cells have got the nuclei which are deeply staining, and some are, and these dysplastic cells are occupying much of the epithelial thickness, whereas in the cancer cells, whereas in the cancer shown in the extreme right, the cells has got much more variation in size and shape, and they are just touching the basement membrane. And if you can see, some of the cells are just invading the invading beyond the basement membrane. They are into the microinvasive focus is shown here. So if this retains, the basement membrane is intact, so this is carcinoma in situ. Whereas if the basement membrane is breached and the cells are found in the subepithelial tissue in the stroma, so this is an invasive focus frank malignancy. For dysplasia to be defined, simply it's a disordered cellular development, as also referred to as atypical dysplasia, hyperplasia. Epithelial dysplasia is characterized by cellular proliferation, and the cytological changes are: one, increased number of layer of epithelial cells, disordered arrangement of cells from the basal layer to the surface layer, loss of basal polarity, that is the nuclei laying away from the basement membrane, and then is the cellular and the nuclear pleomorphism, increased NC ratio, nucleocytoplasmic ratio, nuclear hyperchromatism, deep staining nuclei, increased mitotic activity. The two most common examples of dysplastic changes are uterine cervix and the respiratory tract. Dysplasia. Sphere dysplasia is the most serious form of cervical dysplasia. It's not cancer, but it has the potential to become cancer. Sin 3, cervical intraepithelial neoplasia. This is an example in the cervix. Is usually caused by certain types of human papilloma virus, HPV, and is found when a cervical biopsy is done. If not treated, these abnormal cells may become cancer and spread to the nearby tissues. Sin 3 is sometimes called high-grade or severe dysplasia. And next to this in the severity is the carcinoma in situ, when the dysplastic cells are occupying the whole thickness of cervical epithelium, but the basement membrane is intact. And in the case when the basement membrane is breached and the cells are just going to the stroma, so this is a focus of microinvasive cancer, squamous cell carcinoma, followed by a frank malignancy if this spread to the other sites. Look at this in the normal dysplastic epithelium shown here, whereas mild dysplasia is shown in the basal cell layer. They are deeply staining nuclei, and the moderate dysplasia, these dysplastic cells are just well above the basal cell layer, and in the severe dysplasia they are just occupying the almost whole thickness of the epithelium, and just few layer of cell are identifiable above in the severe dysplasia image. So normal, mild dysplasia, moderate dysplasia, going to the severe dysplasia. Now another term is very important, known as anaplasia. Anaplasia means dedifferentiation. The following changes are noted in the anaplastic cells: loss of polarity, basal polarity. Normally, the nuclei of epithelial cells are oriented along the basement membrane. Nuclei tend to lie away from the basement membrane. This is a change now in the anaplastic cells, pleomorphism, variation in the size and shape of tumor cells, often bigger than normal. NC ratio, nuclei are enlarged, disproportionate to the cell size, and they increase from the normal 1 to 5 to 1 to 1. Aniso nucleosis, variation in size and shape of the nuclei. Here is shown the image. Look at the cells with the multiple nuclei, and then enlarged nuclei are also seen. Tumor joint cell is shown on the right. We are having the variable size nuclei, which is a multinucleated cell, and the on the left side, very large nucleus with bizarre shaped cells, and tripolar mitoses are seen here. And in the background, the cells are having some inflammatory changes also. Any tumor which is anaplastic is to be diagnosed by marker studies. Epithelial markers are going to be employed for that, because the cells are not differentiated properly. They are not resembling their tissue in any way. So that's why you have to differentiate. This is actually an undifferentiated tumor, which has to be differentiated whether it's a epithelial tumor or it's a mesenchymal tumor. So we apply marker studies for that. And immunohistochemistry we will be teaching in the end. And this is another way to diagnose such problems and tumors, because the treatment is aimed in a different way for the epithelial tumors as compared to the mesenchymal tumors. And then we go back to the scenario which is just in the earlier two diagram, which we just put forward. This is a very important scenario from your examination point of view. And the 62-year-old man has an unexpected 5 kg weight loss over 3 months. So weight loss is a feature of malignancy. Liver span is 17 cm. 5 cm below the right costal margin, so liver is enlarged remarkably, and he has occult blood in the stool. So this is a sign there is a hemorrhage, and this has been detected in the stool. Before further workup can be done, he dies in a motor vehicle accident. So autopsy is there, the medical examiner finds massively enlarged liver. So in autopsy, you know, we have to give the cause of the death, whether it's an accidental injury or some metaplastic or any other. So image is shown here. So this is a multiple tumor masses in the liver of variable size. So this lesion seems to be a metastatic lesion. And question number one is, what is the cause of hepatic splenomegaly in the liver? So this is extensive metastatic disease. Note that until approximately 90% of the liver is so replaced, and the patient would not have liver failure. Note that until approximately 90% of the liver is so replaced, the patient would not have the liver failure. So this is a remarkable point. The liver has got tendency to maintain its function until 90% of the liver is so replaced. So there is extensive metastatic disease in the image shown to you. And the second question, what does the stool bag test likely indicate? The colon is a likely site of the primary tumor. The colon is a likely site of primary tumor. Angiogenesis and necrosis of the colonic lesion is responsible for culpability. So colonic cancers tend to metastasize to the liver. It is the first vascular bed they enter after leaving the primary site. So primary site is the colonic cancer, and then is the, this has metastasized to the liver, so that's why liver has got such a texture and appearance. And the last question is, why did we have weight loss? So answer to this, weight loss with cancer can result from elevation of cytokines, which such as tumor necrosis factor by the tumor cells and by the responding host inflammatory cells. Thank you very much.